So thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I enjoy being in communities where you have engaged people. And I think you look like an engaged bunch of people. So my story is a community story from Samsø Island in Denmark. I myself is born and raised on Samsø. I'm the son of a farmer, and I've been working on a farm when I was a kid, and I worked as a farmer also when I grew older. So I'm educated as a farmer before I had any other education. This allows me to talk about a community because I'm from a community. And I know the language of the communities, and I know how the reactions is also in communities, which is kind of a new language for many people. But it's an old language in community aspects. So this island was in 1998 elected to be the Danish Energy Island. And we were supposed to, in 10 years, to change from fossil fuel to renewable energy by using proven technology. So you could say that it sounds like an engineering project, which it was not really, because it was a community project. It was all described as a technical development with wind power, solar energy, and biomass. But when I talked to people in my local community, we had to talk about community power. And this is kind of the way we this is the little formula, a community, which is not really an English word. It's not because I cannot spell, but we try to invent a new word, which is a common, in Danish or in you could say in the European version, a common means something that a community shares, a common value of something. It could be grassland, it could be forest, it could be water, or it could be the wind or the solar or anything else that can be shared. That is a common. And the common plus community makes commonity. I don't know if it makes sense for you. It doesn't for most people in my country, but we're trying to introduce this again to have a common word we can share so we can say this is what we are talking about, creating a commonity, something that the community can share. Samsø is a nice island. It's a beautiful place. It's a nature reserve, and there's a lot of things to protect there. We have to take care of this nature, but we can actually have wind power in this beautiful nature. Maybe you can barely see these wind turbines. That's because it's very early in the morning, and your eyes are not quite open yet. But they are there, the turbines. They're very big. These are 1 megawatt wind turbines, almost 80 meters high. But they're still in the landscape, and they don't really disturb the landscape. So this is just an image of what my island is. But what is a sustainable island? Sustainability is a word that is used in many different situations now. It's like marketing things. You can have a sustainable car, you can have a sustainable house, you can have a sustainable everything. But what is sustainability? I think this is for us to discuss and to define the values of sustainability. I think it's the little things that is different from the highway of development. So this little island in the middle of normality is a place for more biodiversity, for more different opinions, and for more different lifestyles. So sustainability is a mix of everything. We are facing challenges. We have the climate change challenge, we have a challenge of security of supply, and we have a challenge of creating jobs, because everybody wants to have a job so they can feed their family, they can pay the mortgage of their house and their car. So these are the main challenges. But this is kind of policy. This is what all the politicians are talking about. Do we talk about this? Well, for climate, no, not really. Security of supply, well, maybe. Jobs, yes. We want to keep our jobs, for sure. We want to keep some supply here. So we're making a new deal for this. We want to be independent from fossil fuels because they cost more and more and more. And if we're too hooked on fossil fuels, we will be in debt in the future. We need to talk about where is my butter and bread going to come from. Butter and bread meaning where is my job, my income, my livelihood. And they could say, who are we on Samsø? Who are we in your area, in your community? The we is a definition of the community. It's not them and us or them and me, but it's the we in it. This was a perspective 10, 15 years ago. This is an electric car. I mean, I think it's mostly for disabled people. It's not my choice of a car. But today you have a different choice. I mean, the future has developed. And you could also say in this area, things develop quite fast. This is also an electric car. This is a Tesla, very fancy car. I mean, you gentlemen, we'd probably like to have one of these ones if you want to have a car. And you can have an electric car and still be kind of in your wishes of what can be done here, which means that technology will help us. We don't really have to think about that. That is a market-developed thing. But we need to organize it. So back to the community, we should talk about how we can do this. A community can be divided in two. You have the pessimistic people who think that the world will end in a few years because we are over-consuming, we are polluting too much, and everything is a mess. So we think this is more or less the end of the world. Then you have the more optimistic people saying that, well, we spend everything we have on Earth first, and then we'll use other planets later. That will be a solution, no worries. It'll solve itself in a way. Which is, I think, it's maybe the community spirit that we will find a solution. Maybe the income will go down a little bit. Maybe the car will be smaller, our resources will be reduced, but we'll still have each other. We can have a good time and we can share a beer or a cup of coffee or whatever, a cup of tea maybe in Japan, but still we will meet and talk. The NGOs are growing old. I don't know, the average age here is, I don't know, it's a little above average, I think. And many of you are NGOs, I think. You've been fighting for this for many years, and the NGOs are growing old. I'm also a little gray-haired now, so the NGO spirit is a little, it's a little old-fashioned to be NGO. Now you are on Facebook and Twitter, and you're discussing all over the world how things are. So I don't know if you're NGO or you're a community network worker. This is a different attitude to this, that you find your friends all over the world in the networks. The NGOs were small, enclosed clubs of people who were idealistically thinking about how they could save the world. I mean, maybe we still need to save the world, but that's not the approach anymore. So the NGOs, they are struggling because they need to go to a lot of meetings. They need to have a lot of responsibility. They have very little backup in their work. They have declining memberships. They have a strong possible position of a chair for the organization because nobody else wants to be the chair. They have a strong position for own ideas because nobody wants to say anything in a public meeting because otherwise they will be the chair. And they have access to very limited resources. So to be an NGO is kind of a job. So maybe we need to talk about what happened here. You have the Eco Village movement in Denmark. The Eco Village movement was one of the first, they were the first movers. They started thinking about how will we change the world to make eco-villages and build in a different way. So they started using straw bales and mud to build their houses. Coming back to a very original way of doing it. So these straw bale house builders, they made the innovation of a new world and how we could do it. And say actually they started the little fire of interest. They started the idea of changing the world, kind of. We are at a different level now. You say that the fire has been started. And we need to gather people around this fire so we can say that how do we actually develop the new idea, the new paradigm, which is maybe not eco-village, but that's an entire community power development of how we can actually engage the whole community and involve them in the ownership, in the engagement, also in the speaking. How do you create a new language and speak your wishes for the future in a community? And when you talk, while you talk it, you do it. That's an interesting thing. But we have to meet every now and around the campfire. I think you have a word for this in Japanese. Also, you have this table with a fire in the middle. What is it called? Sakibich? Yeah. So you know about this already. You gather your family around this little fireplace in the middle of your table. So just reinvent your own cultural meeting places and use them. But as you have to call in people, because you can do it. This is my old mathematics teacher. When I was a student, I didn't like him so much, and he didn't like me at all. But today he's one of my friends because he's put his first solar panel on the roof because he was in the network of people, house owners, who were the first movers in solar panels. This is 10 years ago. And he invested most of his retirement pension in his roof. He's been quoted in New York Times for saying, it's so much more fun to have my money on the roof than in the bank. And I think he proved that you should act on your own, and instead of just investing your money in some unknown investment capital, it's so much more funny to have your own energy production on your roof. Today it's common, This is my Energy Academy. This is where I work from. This is my office and the meeting place of a lot of people. And we just had a visit from Japan. We have like 5,000-6,000 visitors every year who wants to share this network experience of how we do things. This is also covered with solar panels. Now it's roof integrated and looks maybe a little bit better than in the old days. So what did we do on Samsø to make an impression? We built a lot of district heating. District heating solved the problem with house and space heating. And today, 75% of all heating has been supplied from district heating, from local fuels like biomass and solar, wood chips and stuff like that. So it works perfectly. Then the next thing is the wind power. We needed to produce our own electricity, and we have erected 11 megawatt wind turbine on the island. And these turbines are today supplying 100% of all electricity consumed on the island. The last thing was transportation. How do we solve that? Well, today there's not really technology that can solve this. We have ferries, we have trucks and tractors and stuff like that. So in the meantime, until technology is ready, we have erected 10 offshore wind turbines, and these turbines are producing the same amount of energy we are consuming on transportation, which means that the total CO2 emission or carbon emission has been reduced to a negative output for per capita of approximately 3.5 tons per inhabitant of Samsø, where the average in Denmark is about 10 tons per inhabitant. I don't know how much it is in Japan, but probably around 10 tons also. In America, it's like 15, 17 tons or something like that. So this is how it works. We have erected these turbines. No, it's not working. It doesn't matter. No. Oh, here it is. It's just to prove that I'm not just telling stories. It is actually up and running. These things are here for good. While I'm saying it, how did we involve people in this? Well, we actually went out to people and asked them, do you want to take part of the project? So we invited groups to say, are you going to be investors in wind turbines? You probably have the question also, is this good for the environment? Or is there a problem with birds? Is there a problem with the nature and environmental impact? Is there a problem with low-frequency noise? Will that harm my body? Can I not sleep in the nighttime? And all these sort of questions that is up and running. And we invited people to talk about this and asked them if they wanted to be shareholders. And we said to them, we don't build these turbines unless everybody is invited and everybody can buy a share in the wind turbine. So that was carpenters, farmers, teachers, house owners, and also visitors. Tourists who have a summer house on Samsø was also investors in this project. And it's very funny that today we don't have any protests. We don't have any problems with the wind turbines. The same models that other places causes problems. You get sick from them and you feel very bad about it. But there's a funny coincidence or some impact that if you don't own the shares of the wind turbine, then it looks ugly. It kills a lot of birds and it produces a lot of low-frequency noise that will reduce your health. So I think there's a lot of psychological effect in this, and I think if the entire community says yes to wind turbine, they will also look nice because it's yours. This is the aspect. This is the psychological aspect of this, and I think that is very good. So we're just tapping into proven technology and uses the energy that can be tapped out of this. Local district heating is quite easy. It's a simple technology, and anybody can do it. And you can, easily do it here also. Local plumbers and electricians can erect these things. We buy the straw from the farms, and the farmers are happy because now they have an extra product they can sell, and they can make a living out of this also, selling biomass to the district heating. Instead of us buying the oil from the Middle East or somewhere else, we need to earn a lot of money to be able to import it. Technology can be bought. That is not difficult either. How does it work? Well, if we talk about the networks, in the old days we had big, like was already mentioned, we had big utility companies that produced the energy we needed. Today we have decentralized energy structures, and this works in cooperation with all other things. We can have wind turbines, decentralized heat and power, we can have biogas, we can have solar panels, and all feeds into the same system. And we still have very reliable energy in Denmark. We don't have power cuts or anything like that. It works. And it works because we had some very brave politicians that decided to allow us to have access to the net by law. So the utility companies could not say no if somebody wants to connect a wind turbine or a solar panel or anything like that. But it needs the support of a community asking the politicians to give us this law and give us these regulations saying that this is possible, this is the way we have to do it. So what is the challenge here? Well, this is Denmark. Or it could be Japan, maybe. But this is Denmark. This is the prime minister, and this the little donkey here, that's a very healthy donkey. The donkey is our resource, and the load on the wagon, that's our consumption or our lifestyle. And you could say that, what's wrong with this picture? Well, it's completely out of balance. And the balance is because of our lifestyle, and we have to do something about that. And I think it's easier to do that in a community than it is in a city or in an industrial development, because that's market-driven. Everybody wants everybody to use more, to spend more money, and to be more resourceful. So we have to take some of the load off the wagon and start saving and start doing things. And we can only do that if we agree to do it. Otherwise, it's a competition of being the strongest consumer and producer. But it needs a community to decide what to do, to set up the vision of a future. I think we have done it before. Also in Japan, you have a history. In Denmark, we have a history of wind turbines. 300 years ago, we had a lot of turbines, and they were working to mill the grain, to pump the water, and do all sorts of things. Today, we have electricity-producing wind turbines, generators that are producing all our electricity, and it's same story. It works again like it did before. It serves the community, the services we need here. This is my island. From north to south, it's about 30 kilometers, and we have 4,000 people there. The people in the south, they're the smartest people. They're very intelligent and smart and educated. And the people in the north are not so educated and a little bit different. I live in the South Island, I have to say. The communication is difficult because the north people, they don't understand anything. They have a different dialect and they are a little, you know, I don't have to say so, but you probably know that also the people who live in a different village on the other side of the river or the other side of the mountain, they are also a little bit, you know, different. So this is the communication, what do you call it, challenges that you have. You have to also to talk to the people who don't understand anything, the different people from the other city on the other end of the island. So to do that, we have to focus on where we are. If we have a problem again. Can you move this a little bit? So, Samsø is in the center of Denmark. Yeah, one more. This is Denmark. So you can see Samsø, my island, is right in the center of Denmark. That's good to know because, I mean, we are also the center of Denmark. If you look further ahead, this is Europe. This is the European Union. So you can see Samsø is right in the center of Europe. This is the world, and you can see, I can see some of you are a little bit surprised, but you probably thought that that Japan was the center of the universe, but it's not. But there's this charming thing about the round Earth, that there's no center. Everybody is in the center of the universe, which is the cool thing. So if you consider yourself being in the center, there's no excuse. The next wise step has to be taken from your own position, from your own backyard, that yes, we will do this, because we are in the center of our own acts and thinking. So to do this, we need reliable policy and brave politicians. I don't know if you know any brave politicians. It's a hard job to be a politician, and the brave politicians are a rare species. You have to take care of them and care for them very much, because they live a very dangerous life. If they are not successful, in the first 2 years, they will not be re-elected. And energy planning takes more than 2 years. It's long-term planning, and you have to plan for 10 to 20 years to make things happen. So this is where it's really dangerous. So we need to rely on local individual action plans and strong community networks that can give the inspiration to politicians to make the laws and regulations that we need to be able to act on behalf of the community. But it takes some really brave politicians. So we have to go back to sustainability. We have to eat, excrete, and return to soil and grow. This is a life circle thing. The life circle thing is interesting because this is organic thinking or the circular economy. And I think rural people know more about that than anybody. And you have to think like this also when you elect your politicians, when you make your choices of life and all these sort of things. So back to this, it's all about bread and butter. We need to live and have a good life And it's been mentioned many times, we need to have celebrate this also and meet and have a social life with each other. It means something to interact with each other. So, you have some old hippies here in Japan also. I met this lady in Tokyo at a book signing ceremony. She had this cool t-shirt, no nukes, on it. I thought this was a dying racist, but they're still there, these people who said, no, we don't want this. And I think it takes a community also to do that. But the young people, they are doing it in a different way, and maybe you should set up this communication on all kind of medias and send it out there. So you're not depending on meeting your neighbor, but you can meet your neighbor also virtually. And then it'll end up being like this. All these people, they are talking about energy island development. Yes, energy power. And I think we need this inspiration, this happiness, and share this. I'm so happy that you can share in Japan my experiences on Samsung, because then the inspiration can be, it can work both ways, because if I see you successfully develop what you're doing here, I will be inspired to do the next thing on Samsung also. So it's kind of a win-win situation that every time something good is happening, we need these young guys who can Twitter, who can send it out on Facebook, we see it, wow, they're doing some progress here now in this area. We need to be better because we want to be the world leader. I mean, you have to remember, Samsung is the center of the universe, not this place. If you want more, you can look at the energyacademy.dk, but this is all for me now. Thank you very much.